Hey, Pastor Thom here. I want to welcome you to day three. Francis Chan's Greater Than is as we continue to delve into that. Again, I hope you've enjoyed the last couple of sessions. As I've mentioned before, I really like Francis Chan. I hope you're enjoying him as well. I do want to share with all of you too that, you know, there's going to come a day when we're all back together. And I know some of you, there's several of you that I've talked to that really miss the camaraderie, as do I. And I just want to share with you, the day's coming. The day is coming. We're going to get back together soon. And I really look forward to that day. So with that being said, let's open with a word of prayer. Oh, all-knowing, sovereign, compassionate, and loving God. You know where we're at, and you know how challenging it can be for us who like to be around other people during this time that we're in has been difficult. And so I just personally pray that as we gather electronically and we watch and listen and ask questions and answer questions, that we can put ourselves in a place where we can feel some kind of connection with each other. Lord, bless each person who is watching as we watch separately, but in spirit are together. Lord, bless our time together. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So our opening song is one of my favorites, Chain Breaker by Zach Williams. And as always, sing if you feel like it. Don't sing. Stand up, even if you're at home, if you feel like it. Enjoy.
If you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles, if you've been hearing the same old voice, tell the same old lies, if you're trying to fill the same old holes inside, there's a better life. There's a better life. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom, a savior, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain breaker. We've all searched for the light of day in the dead of night. We've all found ourselves worn out from the same old fight. And we've all run to things we know just ain't right. And there's a better life. There's a better life. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. Feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom, a savior, he's a prison shaking savior. You got chains, oh, he's a chain breaker. If you believe it, if you receive it, you can feel it, somebody testify. If you believe it, you receive it. You can feel it, somebody testify, testify. If you believe it, if you receive it. If you can feel it, somebody testify. If you feel alone,
So our scripture comes from the book of Revelation. I'm going to be looking at chapter 20. I'll be reading verses 11 through 15. Then I saw a great white throne and him who was seated on it. From his presence, earth and sky fled away, and no place was found for them. And I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne, and books were opened. Then another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged by what was written in the books, according to what they had done. And the sea gave up the dead who were in it. Death and Hades gave up the dead who were in them. And they were judged, each one of them, according to what they had done. Then death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. This is the second death, the lake of fire. And if anyone's name was not found written in the book of life, he was thrown into the lake of fire. Here ends the reading of God's holy word. Amen. And now the video. Enjoy session three of the video.
So we've been talking about how the Bible explains that there's a creator. That you and I, we're not accidents. But God had a purpose for us. He made everything, including us. And it was all for His glory. We were made to bring Him glory, just like the heavens. And we talked about how when there's rebellion, like there was with Adam and Eve, there were consequences. God says sin brings death. And so the consequences weren't just for Adam and Eve, but they affect us today, because that's what rebellion does. It doesn't just affect you, it always impacts other people. It impacts future generations, just like our parents and their sin affects us, and our sin will affect our kids, and on and on and on. But what the Bible also teaches, and this is where it gets really intense, is that the consequences of our rebellion, it's not just what we face here and now. The Bible talks about this future judgment, and talks about in the end there's going to be eternal consequences. And this is so hard to stomach, but it's in the Bible. In the very end, in Revelation 20, it talks about this judgment time. In Revelation 20, verse 10, it talks about the devil and how he was thrown into the lake of fire and sulfur, where the beast and false prophet were, and they will be tormented day and night forever and ever. And then it goes on, and in verse 11, it talks about, then I saw a great white throne and him who was seated on it. From his presence, earth and sky fled away, and no place was found for them. And I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne, and books were opened. And then another book was opened, which is the book of life, and the dead were judged by what was written in the books according to what they had done. It talks about a day when that being sits on this throne and he judges. And it gets even crazier, because in verse 15 it says, if anyone's name was not found written in the book of life, he was thrown into the lake of fire. There were consequences for action, not just right here during this time on earth, but for the future. He says there's consequences there, and they're eternal. He talks about something so intense, because just like we talked about, the holiness and the greatness of this creator is so far beyond what we can imagine, so is his justice. That's why we read that and we go, are you serious? It's that intense. The judgment is that intense. But there's something else in the Bible that we learn about God, and this is where it gets very difficult to believe. The Bible says that as holy as he is, as righteous as he is, and how he has this sense of justice, the Bible speaks so much about his love. The fact that there wasn't just fairness of, okay, these people sinned against me, they rebelled, so here's the punishment. But it goes deeper than that, in that it says that he loves his creation, that he looks at these people and goes, man, they rebelled, so I have to punish. Because I'm a righteous God, I'm a just God, I'm a God of justice, I must punish. The Bible says he does not leave the guilty unpunished. But at the same time, he says, I love them. And so what he does is, in Romans 5:8, it says that God demonstrates his love for us in that while we were sinners, Christ died for us. And what he's saying is that God looks at the world and says, as much as I love them, he goes, I don't want to punish them. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to show love like no one has ever shown them. I'm going to have my son take the form of a man, and he's going to die on the cross for their sins. And Romans 3:26 says this way he could be fair, he could be just, but he could also be the justifier. In other words, he couldn't just overlook sin. Someone had to pay for it. And he talks about this in the Old Testament. Back in the day, what they used to do was God commanded them, look, what I want you to do is I'm going to actually have you do these animal sacrifices. It's called an atonement, where they would slaughter these animals. And the idea was that the blood shed by those animals was a picture of someone having to pay for their crimes. Because without the shedding of blood, the Bible says there's no forgiveness of sins. And it was all a picture of the sacrifice that would happen one day. Isaiah talks about that in Isaiah 53, how there was going to come this servant who would actually pay for the sins of the world. And most of us have heard of John 3:16, where it says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life. I mean, the thought that God, if he really is that great, if he really is that holy, that powerful to create this world, and he really is that just to where he causes and inflicts his punishment and his curse upon the earth for sin, and he has this eternal judgment, man, that powerful being, why would he love us that much? So love us that he would send his son. I mean, I think about this as a dad. I picture my son, and I think about everything I feel about my son and all the good times we've had together and just the laughter, the tears, whatever. Man, just the thought of me taking my son and maybe taking him to death row and showing him all these inmates, you know, who are there that committed the most heinous crimes and to say, son, I actually love these guys. I'm actually crazy about these guys. And so here's what I'm going to do is I'm going to have you punished for them. I'm going to have you nailed to a cross. I mean, I try to imagine my son's face and I try to imagine, see him go through that. I mean, as a dad, I would go nuts. I can't do that. I can't watch that. And the thought that the Father, Almighty God, went through that for me, it's amazing. It is very hard to believe, but the Bible says whoever believes will not perish but have eternal life. And so the question is do I really trust him? Do I really believe him? Do I really believe that my Creator, a holy and fair God, also is a God of love, a love that goes beyond anything we've ever experienced? That he sent his son, had him take the form of a man, and had him nailed to a cross to pay for my crimes. And because of that, I'm forgiven. That all of my sins have been washed away. That he took it all on the cross for me. And the Bible says that after he was dead and he was buried, that 3 days later, he rose from the dead. To show that he really was the Messiah, he really was the Christ, he really was the one that was going to die for the sins of the world. He rose from the dead and he's alive today. And the Bible says we can begin this relationship with him, we can know him. Despite everything we've done, and we all have our secrets, we all have the things that we are so ashamed of that we don't want anyone to know about, and yet God knows those. And the Bible says that's why I sent my son. He paid for that. And if you believe that he died on that cross for your sins, if you believe He rose from the grave, you won't face my judgment. You can be free from all of that, and you can have eternal life. And for some of you, maybe tonight is that time, like we talked about that first day, about how God set things up so that you would feel your way towards Him and find Him. And maybe tonight's the night where you finally get it. I remember, man, I saw crosses growing up and I never got it. I never really understood what they meant. And maybe tonight is the first time that you go, I get it. And I want it. I think this was God's process, bringing me here, surrounding me with these people, this environment. Man, it all makes sense. And now even the tragedy, the pain has caused me to feel my way towards Him. And now I know, I get it. I want Him. I know Him. Even all the mistakes I've made in life that I'm ashamed of, because I want to be forgiven. Maybe this is the night. And we want to give you that opportunity to begin the most amazing relationship on this earth.
So what did you think of the video? I hope you found it as interesting and intriguing as I did. Again, I hope you share your comments and questions with one another in the comment section and maybe have some dialogue there about it. But here's some questions, comments I have. So thinking back on the past couple of sessions, day one, day two, and after hearing the video and perhaps after hearing the Revelation scripture, maybe you want to go back and reread that. What comes to your mind with regard to God's character? Who is God? 1 John 4:8 through 9 says this. 1 John. Okay, 1 John 4, 8 through 9. Anyone who does not love does not know God, because God is love. In this the love of God was made manifest among us, that God sent His only Son into the world so that we might live through Him. So God is love. And so in light of the Revelations passage, we hear that God is going to throw some people into hell, basically, right? Into this fiery pit. But God is love. So I want you to think about this too. Maybe even pause the video after I'm done with this statement. How would you explain to somebody who God is, when you have scripture that says God is love and God's going to throw people into hell? How would you describe God based on those things? Francis Chan refers to this concept of sin, right? Because that's really what we're talking about here. That's where we end up going to the lake of fire, is through unrepentant sin and missing the mark. The mark being God's standard, right? So have we ever missed the mark? Dumb question, right? We've all missed the mark. We've all sinned. We've all fallen short. Romans 3, 23 tells us that. It says, all have fallen short of the glory of God. Romans 6, 23 says, for the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. For the wages of sin is death. Question: why does God take sin so seriously? Another question: how should we respond to sin in our lives? Another question. Thinking about how we should respond to the sinner in our lives, what is the great news in that? Okay, another comment here. Or maybe a question. Maybe I should phrase this as a question. Could you tell your child, could you walk up to your child and tell them that you're going to send them away to suffer in the same way that Jesus suffered? And you're going to do it for the rapist, you're going to do it for the murderer, you're going to do it for the thief, you're going to do it for all the liars, the gossipers, adulterers, etc. Could you do it? That's what God did. Another question. How does Jesus show that he is both just and the justifier? Why is this important in our understanding of God as creator of all that exists? Those are the questions I have for you. And my hope is that based on the questions I shared, that maybe that'll spawn some other questions you have, or maybe you have questions already running through your mind. Post those questions, comment, throw them out there. Because like I said before, there's people out there that need to hear those things. There's people out there with questions that may not ask questions, and you might be the first one to ask it. And somebody out there, you're going to respond and answer that question, and that may be exactly what somebody needed to hear that day. So I'm leaving it in your capable hands to have some dialogue over this and to share openly. So with that all being said, let's close in prayer. Loving God, we know you as a loving God. We know that's your character, but we also know that you have standards. We know that there's sin in our lives, and we know that we should be repentant of that sin, and that we should be constantly working out that sin and working toward perfection to be as Christ-like as possible. Lord, help us to see the sin in our lives so we can be a repentant people. And help us to be very specific about our sins, and help us to have the Holy Spirit help us overcome those things. Lord, we know there's a heaven and a hell, and we're very grateful that we have come to know your Son as our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. But we also know there's challenges ahead, and it's not always easy in this life to be a follower of his 100% and 100% of our time and our energy is very difficult for us. So we pray that you continue to build us up, encourage us, and guide us in whatever way, shape, or form that you feel that we need to be guided. We pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. And our closing song is Who You Say I Am. Enjoy. God bless you guys. See you soon.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Who the Son sets free. Jesus died for me. Yes, he died for me. Who the Son sets free, always free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. I'm a child of God. Yes, I.